see Jeff Ward's picture and this whole thing of missions coming up. Jeff Ward is a close friend of ours. He's actually his wife, and his wife's brother is a very close friend of mine. That's how we came to know him. So he has made an impact in my life, especially through Trisha's brother, Sky. And then he had been an influence in our lives, in our family life. And then we came to know Jeff. So now to see him in his pictures like that, to do work in India, that's amazing. To see a man of God give up everything in Austin and just went to serve God. So I think it's a good start for me to stand up here this evening to share the word of God with y'all. Last time when I stood here, we talked about the life of Timothy and what we learned from Timothy, Paul's encouragement, Paul's direction to Timothy. And I want to lead on from there and move on to today, what the Lord has for us. And I was preparing for this, so I want to be sharing this with y'all. And until last night, I was still struggling what to share, because Brother George has asked me to take a series, so it has to be this week and next week also. So I was struggling. It's just one big sermon is easy, okay? Easy in the sense that you can just pick a topic and prepare and do, but we want to continue. And so I was struggling and asking the Holy Spirit to lead and direct. And amazingly, the message for us today is some encouragement. I think the Lord impressed upon my heart early in the morning today to go and encourage each one of us. Encouragement. So the message today will be encouragement. The first part, and then it actually leads on. See how the Holy Spirit works. I went for a morning Bible study early morning, and I was a bit disturbed because I still haven't got a message, and I was preparing for tonight or this evening. So what the Lord has, so discouraging. But then there was a word that came out very clearly in the morning Bible study for me was, you know, God has called you, God has chosen you, which means it goes back again, it's a reaffirmation of what I shared with you all last, which from Acts 17 verse 26. I want to start there and then move on to today's topic. Acts 17, do we have it up? If not, that's okay. Acts 17, 26 says, and he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. The prayer earlier from Sister Sunita is also leading into that same thing. So God has a plan, and he has appointed each one of us to be here today, to be in Austin for a planning purpose. It's not that we came here or we desired to come here. And another encouragement, just want to add on to what the Lord presses. About 10 o'clock, I received a call from Sister Ramya. She just called and said that I Googled and got your name. I want to just ask about this Indian church, and then we talked. And I said, okay, it's good. I'll come and pick you up, and then we went and picked up. Okay. It's an assurance how God appoints and gives you confidence that He is our God. And that's the confirmation, you know, one by one from last night. And if God can lead a person like this to give you confidence and assurance, that same God is what you and I are worshiping. So He wants to encourage us today. So with that, He has appointed us this place, this time of the season, this sanctuary or whatever you want to call it, and in this period of our life, for us to do something here in Austin, for us to do something here in Austin, ACFI, with our families and our children and all. So I want that to be, you know, rooted in today, and also next week I'll be just touching on that also. So that, more and more I was looking at what to speak, it points to Joshua. It's the life of Joshua, which is a very common chapter, Joshua chapter 1, verses 6 to 9. That was the earlier one, and then we'll just go to the scripture portion today. Joshua chapter 1, verses 6 to 9. I'll read and then pray. It says like this, be strong and of good courage, for to this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed. The Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this assurance. Thank you for the message of encouragement that you have for us tonight. And Father God, Holy Spirit, you are in control. You control our lives, and you know the innermost struggles that we are going through. And Father, we pray that you will just speak to us tonight. Help us to have an open heart to receive your word. And your word is alive. Your word is true. It spoke to the people in the Old Testament, and it's speaking today to all of us. And Father God, I just ask that you will just take control of the entire message time and the worship, that you are in control. You are sovereign. You know our hearts, and speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, this week's news is all about Steve Jobs. Everybody talks. A man who made an impact in the world. Okay, and I'm sure all of you have heard about that. Yes, he made an impact. But we worship a God who made a bigger impact, or the biggest impact on earth 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ. You see, the comparison people in this culture, they look at Steve Jobs. And, I mean, nothing wrong about that. Yes, he made an impact. There's a lot of revolution, there's a lot of changes that we are enjoying today because of this one man. But our God is even greater than that. But we hear news like that. And then yesterday or last night, we heard about another brother in San Francisco or in Sacramento passing away. A sad news again. We have been praying for that family in our all-night prayer. And I think Brother Alex have gone there for the funeral service. So we hear news of people passing, young age, going away like that. This morning in my Bible study, there was another person sharing that a young man died, and they were the whole company. He works in Cisco, and he was saying the whole company is shocked in the Austin office when we heard this news. He's 42 years old. That is the uncertainty that we are going through in this world. Okay, today, you hear this kind of thing. And so what we go through is, when that kind of news comes, there is fear and other things that come and hit us. When this kind of news and other things come and fail, you know, just hit us, we go through a kind of fear. What is happening? What's going on? Where is this heading in my own life? Then we take it back to our life. What is happening in my life? What is going on? Then we have a desire, that fear is there, but we have a desire that I want to continue. I want to be successful. I want to do great things. I want to have a good family. I want to bring up my children in the right way so that they will be good citizens. We have that struggle going on this side. But we try to suppress the fear that it's with us, and then we try to take care of this outwardly with our children and our struggles that we go through at work and all that. That is what this world, or the life that you and I am no different. We are just going through that pressure that comes top of us every moment, at home, at work, you just name it, everywhere. The society, the culture here, it just brings you that kind of pressure on us also. And we have this mindset, or all of us have, that we don't want to fail. We want to succeed. We want to do good things. We want to do good things for our children. We want our children to do well in studies. We want to succeed in our workplace. We want to move up. There's an opportunity. We don't want to lose that. Because we tell to ourselves, you know, this is what God has brought us here, so we need to do well. So we don't want to fail. And you bring it again from the outside world. We also don't want to fail as a church. ACFI, we should not fail. So we try to do a lot of things. We say that, oh, we have not done this for the last 10 years. We've done this starting, and then we started that way. We're not doing correctly now. Let's correct it. So we go through that struggle as a church. Bring it even closer. We struggle it within our families. We try to do a lot of things with our family and then ourselves. So big picture, small picture, you just take it. It is pressure. The pressure is on us every time. But what is the standard? How do we want to overcome this? How do we want to handle this? We can just go by what the standard of the world is, and they have formulas, right? I mean, you go to a bookstore, sometimes it's, nowadays I don't even go to a bookstore, but you go even to the Christian bookstore, you just try and see. You'll have 7 steps for success, 7 steps to do this, 10 steps of whatever you want to do, you can bring up your children. You have all kinds of steps given up, and I mean written in books and books and books. That's what the world gives you. And sometimes we try and, okay, you take this, okay, you take this, you want to read this. I've read some in the past, and it's not, but our standard is where? Our standard is God, our standard is the Word of God. And that's what we want to look at. And the situation is going to be even worse as we grow, as we live in this part of the world, it's going to be difficult. So, with that, the Old Testament, Joshua's time, he faced the same, similar kind of situation. We want to take some encouragement from that. Verse 6. So, three areas that are, three principles that I picked up from here, and we just looked from these three principles. If you remember last month when I talked about Timothy, Paul was talking to Timothy and said that be strong. And it's the same word that appeared again. And I was like, oh, maybe it's coincidence. No, it's the Holy Spirit's leading and just led me to Joshua and says, be strong and courageous. So three times. Verse 6, verse 7, and verse 9. So we're going to just look at verse 6, verse 7, and 8 together, and then verse 9. Every time in the Word of God, there is a three times. I think I mentioned this in my Bible studies also. No? Even our own children and all that. When you call three times, when you say something, come here, nothing happens. Come here. Then you raise your voice and say, come here. And then you see your children coming. So third time is really a forceful a reason for what you are doing. You know, a three-time repetition. Here I see the same thing three times. I didn't catch it. You know, I've gone through this many times. But I'm beginning to understand why Joshua needs this encouragement. This needs this support of be strong and courageous. Okay, so verse 6. Be strong and courageous. Why? Because there is a job for him at hand. There is a big job. And today, the same thing. So what is courage? So I went and, I mean, nowadays we have the internet, right? So Google, what is courage? I want to understand what is courage. So it comes out like this. Bravery. So this is not from me, it's from the Google, okay? Bravery, fearlessness, heroism, confidence. Okay? So that's what the whether the definition or whatever you want to call it, the translation for the word courage. And another place, how to simplify that, so they put it is, you know, they call it several nicknames. And they put it, you know, you have the guts, or you have the backbone. Okay, sometimes we say, do you have the backbone to stand up? That's courage, another way to look at it. Or do you have the guts, and people, you know, tell like that. That's another way of saying, do you have courage? Okay, so that's kind of things. So I wanted to get you all some idea what does that mean, because I want to understand also, it says be strong and courageous, be strong and courageous. So you need that boldness, the courages that we have. Some of us are doing the study of Acts, you will see the same thing, boldness and courage. For Peter, Paul, you will see the same thing in Acts. So the courage and strength goes together here. So why we need this? So because Joshua, you have a task to do. You know the life of Joshua, right? So he's transitioning. Moses has died and moved on. And the leadership for the Egypt, the people from Egypt moving into the land of Canaan is now on Joshua. So he has to lead. And he has a big thing. He cannot fall back. Joshua, Moses is gone. Moses dead and gone. So he cannot fall back to look at the leader anymore. He doesn't have any support. And in that stage is where this verse comes to him. Be strong and courageous. So he has a big task in front of him, and he needs that strength. God is speaking to him. Okay? And we see the same thing in various people's life in the Old Testament. We looked at David. David had the courage and the strength to go and face up with Goliath. That is the strength. So I'm just trying to illustrate to see the difference that, I mean, the similarities that we need to have. The strength and the courage that you need to have is not like, okay, I can take care of this. No. It's beyond that. It's big. How do you face it? Look at what David did. He was a young man, a young boy. He was able to stand up and face it. Moses, okay, look at the life of Moses. He was hiding at one point. He came back, he was able to face Pharaoh. Pharaoh's the king, okay? And he was able to stand in front of Pharaoh and talk to him and challenge him. That is the strength and that is the courage that he had. Where did he get that? It's again from God. You look at one more person. I'm just giving some Old Testament people that we can just relate back. Elijah. You know the story of Elijah when he was challenging the prophets of Baal or Baal at Mount Carmel? Okay, he says like this: if the Lord is God, you follow him. If Baal is God, follow him. What kind of strength and power that they had? Okay, and that are the leaders that were there. And so God is giving the same encouragement now for Joshua. Joshua needs that strength. Joshua needs that courage to go and take these people into the land. And so he starts to look back and say, I need this. And I think probably he would have remembered back the struggles that Moses went through and how God led Moses, because he was an assistant. He was the second, but two people was the only one who was able to see this process of Moses leading until this end. Joshua, another one was Caleb. Okay, these are the only two people. The rest of the young men all have died. Okay, so he was able to see at this stage of his life, probably he was about 40 years old, taking over the leadership. So he's able to see the struggles, the way that God led Moses. And it's told, you can read that in Deuteronomy chapter 1, verses 26 onwards, you can see, you would have seen Moses' struggle and how Moses depended on God, took God's the strength from God to move on. And here he says, you lead the people. Verse 6. For you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. You do it. Joshua, this is your job. It's your task. And he's giving that encouragement. So the question is, do you feel or do I feel that we have a battle that is really a big one that we cannot face? A uphill battle in our lives? You may be going through that sometimes, not right now. And you might be thinking that, I don't know how to overcome this. Sometimes we go through hundreds of these things day by day, small things. Will I have a job? How am I going to take care of my finance need? Who's going to take care of my parents? Now, most of us are here, and our parents may be in India or other parts. We'll be going through these kind of struggles. It's impossible. No, I have to do this. We might be going through this. Or we may be struggling in other areas. You will know. I know that it is not something that we don't go through. We all go through that. And there could be something from outward struggles that we go through. Probably, sickness. That is this is bothering me as we age. Relationship. Or as I've said, financial. It should be also from external. That we don't know how to handle this kind of thing. Or you're about to lose a job, or you're not sure whether you will have a job tomorrow. That kind of uncertainty. Then you'll have this inner struggles that you may be going through. The faith. Can I trust God? Will God really help me out in this situation? I've been praying over this for a long time. Will God show me what is my next step in my job, in my family, or raising my kids? Will God help me out in my sickness or in the illness that I'm going through? Or we're going through some attacks of the Satan that comes, and our theme is, it's warfare against the evil one. We may be going through that kind of attack. How do I handle this? Every now and then, the testimony that I was sharing this morning, what happened last night to this morning, it's a battle, it's a spiritual battle that we go through. How do we face that? How do I handle that? Many times we go through this. And I think God is calling you and I with this encouragement. Be strong, encourage us. Because the task is there. It's ahead of us. God is calling us. We need to do that. What we need to do, a few things I want to just put in front of you. Acts 1:8 says, you will be my witnesses. Okay. So we have a task. We have a calling to be his witness. And And that could be the thing that we said, we don't know how to share this gospel with others, or friend, or a task that is a big problem that we are battling with. How can I share this gospel? How can I be a witness for others? Or how God can prepare me to be a witness, or to be a living sacrifice, like Romans 12 says, you be a living sacrifice. You struggle through, you say, Lord, I want to be a living sacrifice for you as a person that is acceptable, that people look at me, that I am living a Christian life, but I'm failing every time. And you may be struggling that in your life. But I think, like Joshua, we are in the same boat. But he has a bigger task. He had a bigger task. But God was with him. God is with us. Okay. But there's one easier way to do this and say that, okay, I want to quit. Okay, and say that, okay, that's it. I'm not going to take it on anymore. So we go through the struggles in the Christian warfare and we say that, I don't want this Christian life. Maybe we won't say that because all of us are believers here. What we will do, we'll stack back. Okay, I've gone through this in my own life as working for God or doing great things for God. And then suddenly you take back step and say that, Lord, I want to step back. You know what happens? When you step back, you really go behind and behind. The church moves on. The work of God moves on. That's what's going to happen. That's a true example in my own life. So we may be wanting to quit. I want to encourage you, don't do that. Okay. Or we just say, okay, status quo. I'll come every Saturday, 5 o'clock, punch my time here in ACFI. Everybody see me, and then I'm gone. Okay. Do you want to do that status quo? I think God has a bigger thing for us. God has a bigger thing for you and me here in ACFI. The task is big. But I don't want to scare you all. Big task. There is, God is moving in our midst. And God is moving truly in our midst. And you can do small things. And that is the task that probably God is asking you to do. It may be insignificant for the whole church to look at it, but you may be witnessing to one person. You may be helping one person that is in need here within our church. That is a task that is at hand. If you are not doing that, no one is going to do that, or no one is doing that. You know it, I know it, what we can do to help our brothers and sisters here in Christ. And maybe outside, I don't know, you would. But again, God is telling us, I've called you, and the task that is ahead, I've called you. God has called us. God has called Joshua, and he's given him the strength to do it. Okay, he's given him the courage to move on. And so the task is there, and Joshua was given that encouragement, be strong and courageous, go face the task, divide the land, conquer the land, take over the land. Today, the same call is to us. Okay, the task is there. It could be small, it could be big. The task is there for each one of us. You know what it is. And if you're not sure, pray about it. Ask God to lead you, to direct you. The Holy Spirit is a living person. Okay, just pray and ask God to guide you through, and he will. Let's move on to the second thing. Verse 7 and 8. It says, only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. I want to break this up into three portions of it on the being obedient. So my second principle, the first one is, there is a task. Second is, be obedient to the commands or to the law, and obeying the law. So I want to just break it up. Obey the law, all the law. He didn't say obey part of the law. Okay, look at again the verse 7. To do according to all the law. Okay, the Old Testament is all the law. And so for Joshua, the command is given, obey all the law, okay, not part. And so God's word is so powerful today. And so God is reminding Joshua, you want strength. For you to get the strength, you obey the law that is given. Obey the law that was given through Moses to all of the Israelites at that time, or the Jews. Okay, obey. And that's what it is. And so the command today for us is not part. The word of God is given to us. How fortunate and how privileged we are that we can carry the word of God, and we have different translations. We have all kind of things. And I think we have come to a stage where we have the word of God in our, you know, our handheld portables that we are carrying. We can go to that extent. It's given. Okay, what a privilege it is to carry the word of God. But having the word of God alone is not enough. But it says obey all. And here it says law. But I think we can apply it to our lives today. It's the word of God. Okay, so we have to obey. And second, the first part I said obey. Second, do not turn from it to the right or to the left. What does that mean? When we read the word of God, and you have this world thing coming into our lives, shall I take a portion of this? Maybe this is tailored for me, and then I let go of this. And that's what the struggle that we go. But here, because the world is influencing us, this is okay. You know, we hear preachers, we hear sermon after sermon, and then we hear someone says, okay, this is okay for us if you do this. We go back to the word of God, and I think that is the foundation for us. And sometimes we put our own parameters, I call it, or maybe you want to call it as a fan, and say that, okay, this one I think is okay, God will accept that because this is what the word interprets for me. And then we tend to do this because we put our own limitation, our own walls, or I would say parameters or fans, and say, I can go until this end. If the word of God says this, then we have to stick to what the word of God says. And that's where you will have the strength that you need and the courage that we get from God, and He can be able to guide us through. And if we put that and follow that, only then you'll get the strength from God. Otherwise, you're going to be just tossed around from what the world is giving us. And the third one, meditate on it day and night. Okay, meditate on it day and night. You know, I have this tendency also. You know, sometimes I skim through. We skim through. It says, okay, chapter 1. And then you just go through. And today, I want to read the Word of God. You just go through and it says, okay, this is what it says. But that's what I go through. I want to confess. Okay? I think what the Bible clearly says, read and meditate and let the Word of God speak to us. I'm not doing that. How many of us are in that same boat? I'm not sure. And sometimes we just read it because it's like a story. Okay, I just read it. But we don't ask God to illuminate or enlighten us from the Word of God, because the Word of God is true. If this is true and if this is life, why am I not spending and asking God to speak to us through the Word of God? I'm guilty of that. Okay, I stand in front and just want to confess. Sometimes we just skim through. Because I have this tendency, it says, okay, it says here like that, let me go here. And then we just stand on and you just get lost. And then after that, okay, this is enough for today. And then we move on. But I don't study the Word of God. And I think that is what God wants us to do today. So the encouragement I want to leave you out is, spend time in the Word of God. Spend time. Read the Word of God. This morning, I don't know whether it is what God wants me to do is. So there was one person in our Bible study, and he was saying how he came. There's a testimony time, and he says how he was going through a struggle in his life where he had a marital problems. God spoke through another person and told him to read the Word of God. And he says, and that person told him, read one book for 30 times. We all were like, 30 times. So we were asking him, do you read 30 times like one book and then you move on to another one? And he said, just take a book and then move on and then come back to it 30 times and then you will understand it. I thought that was amazing. And we were all having questions, and some of us were asking him, do you read Leviticus 30 times? You know, and things like that we were asking him. But then it just dawned on a few of us is, this is important. Because the Word of God, when you start reading, it speaks to us differently. A few years ago, you read Acts, it speaks differently. You come back again and you read Acts, it will speak differently. You attend another Bible study, next week, you read the same chapter, it will speak. Maybe that is what our Word of God is, because it's alive, and it will speak to you. And so, I want to encourage you to read the Word of God and just get the strength and the courage that we need from the Word of God. And that's what Joshua has been directed to do. Go, look at the law, obey the law, just submit yourself to the law. So it's not an automatic thing that you say, Lord, I'm struggling, I need the strength, give me the courage. No, it's not going to come. God has given us the living word. And it's our duty, it's not automatic, our duty to read this word of God, and the word of God will speak to us appropriately at the time that we need. And it's day and night that we have to be grounded in the word of God. If you look at again, I like the life of Timothy. Paul talks to Timothy about the same thing. He will talk in 2 Timothy verse, chapter 3 verse 16. Okay, if you look at that, that is a great important verse, okay, because that's a living word and he will encourage him. So Timothy's life, Paul is encouraging the same thing. You must know the word of God. Here all of us, we come and go, but I want to encourage you that we need the word of God in our lives. Let's move on to the third one. Verse 9. Again, have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid nor dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. The first one is, be strong and courageous because you have a big task to do. Second, be strong and courageous by learning and by being obedient to the word of God, or to the laws for him, for us to be word of God. And finally, the same command comes to us. Be courageous. Be strong and courageous because we have one more small thing or big thing to say. I am with you. What an assurance that we have. See, the humanly, we can try to do everything, but we have one assurance that God is with me. I am with you. I am with you. God gives that confidence and the commandment that I am with you. He gives us. If you look at Matthew 28:20, the second part, it talks about, you know, the Great Commission. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So the command that Joshua got from chapter 1, verse 9, is the same thing Jesus gives to the disciples. And it's the same thing today for us. So we can take courage. We can take that confidence that we go out for us, from here today, that God is with us. So all of us believers, brothers and sisters, I want us, you know, this message is a message of encouragement for all of us. Let us be strong. Okay? Don't get terrified and worked up and get scared about what's going on in life, the world. The world is going to give you the pressures I've said earlier. But let's be strong because God has promised, I am with you. I am with you till the end of age. Okay? And then what are we going to see? If we say that God is with us, you have the confidence he is walking with us, then what do you see? And that's the end part. Okay. Actually, it comes earlier. He says, you will have good success and prosperous. I don't want to talk about the success and prosperous, but I want to leave with you all that he will give you the strength to move on because he is going to be giving us the victory that we need. The victory in our job place, victory at home, victory in everything that we do, that he's going to give us because he's the one who's going to guide us through. That's what I said. And there is a task that is given to us ahead of us. And we need to be obedient to do that. And he is with us. So the question I want to just throw in front is, where is your life today? What struggles are you going through that you need this encouragement? God is giving us this encouragement. And he's a powerful God. He says, be strong and courageous. I am with you. I'm not going to be letting you go. I'm not going to let you down. I am with you. Okay. What a God that we serve. Okay. And there is no shortcut. So don't think that there is shortcut in the sense that, okay, God, you are with me, and then I don't have to read the word of God. I don't have to be doing what he has asked me to do. Then there's no benefit. I think we have to be systematically studying the word of God, let the word of God speak to us, be obedient to the call that he has called us to do. There's a task in every one of our lives. He has called us to do something, and we have to have that. And only then we will have this assurance that we have the security in God. The world will not give us security. As I've started, right? This world, you will hear news like that, people passing away. All the negative things is going to come and come. Every time we want to move on, something will come negative to just pull us back down. That's what. So our security has to be in the Lord. It has to be holding on to God. So let me ask, is there something missing in your life? Is there something that you're struggling with? That you think that I have no way, I'm gone, I need help. And the Word of God says, be strong and courageous. I am with you always. What a God we serve. Our God is a God who's living. And He's going to give you best. We all go through struggles. We all go through ups and downs in our life. But He's the only one who's going to be with us. No one, the world, the friends, nobody's going to be with us. When we go alone, you're going to face it one and one by yourself. At that time, this is where you need to go. This is where you get your strength. Encouragement from the Word of God says that I am with you. The Holy Spirit is just walking alongside with you in your journey. He's going to just lead you. If you are struggling tonight, I want to encourage you that He is your God. He's the one who's going to lead us through. Next week, we're going to look at the last chapter of Joshua. We saw how he's starting his ministry, the battle that he has to win, or the battle that is ahead of him. Then at the end, we'll see what he's doing. Now, he started at the age of 40. He's going to finish it at the age of 110. He'll be moving on. At that time, what he has to tell. Okay, what he has to tell to the Jews or to the Israelites. We want to learn that next week. And we're going to do something next week. Okay, it talks. I want to leave it to you all. So please come. And how God can use us. The strength that He's going to give us, the courage that He's going to give us to go to the next level in our lives. We are not losers. We cannot be losers in this world. We cannot. If 11 people, 11 disciples can shake the world, and it's going on and on, we should be part of this. That's why I put the Acts 17:26. We are part of that journey. And we have to move. We have to shake the world. We have to shake Austin and move on. So I want to encourage you to come next week. Hear the Word of God. Let's look to the Lord. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this day. I want to thank you for speaking to us through thy Word. Your Word is powerful. Your Word is living. And Father God, we want to thank you for the encouragement that you've given to us through the book of Joshua. And what an amazing God that we serve. Your Word is powerful, living, and we can take it. And Lord, we thank you that you have saved. Even to the ends of the world, I am with you. Thank you for this courage that we can take and the hope that we have, the security that we have in you, that we can hold on to you because you have promised that till the end of the age, I am with you. Help us to cling on to you at all our times. Lord, if there's anyone here who are going through struggles, who have questions, and I pray, Lord, Holy Spirit, you minister to them, even right now, and even as they walk back home, I pray that you just speak to them. One more time, help them to look at what you have done in the life of Joshua. Just minister to them so that the word that is spoken today will not go void. I just ask for your hands and your leading. Lead us through, prepare our heart for next week too. In Jesus' name we pray.